and welcome to the historic White Rock Baptist Church, located at 3400 Fayetteville Street in Durham, North Carolina, where the Reverend Dr. Reginald Van Stephens is the pastor. Thank you for giving us the opportunity today to bring God's house into your house. And so we are excited about what God has done for us and what He continues to do for us each and every day. So call a friend, text someone, tweet someone, and even talk to someone to tell them that there is a word from the Lord today. So let's worship the Lord in spirit and in truth. And we pray that you enjoy today's pre-recorded Worship of Christ service at the historic White Rock Baptist Church.
So let us worship Him in spirit and in truth. To God be the glory. Let us pray. We gather as your people to worship you, O Lord. And as we gather, we pray, Lord, that you will come. Let your Holy Spirit enlighten our minds. Come as holy truth to teach us your way. Come as holy wind to blow your spirit fresh upon us. Come as holy fire, O Lord, to cleanse us from all sin. Come as holy power to send us into your service. Fill us now, O God, with your love and your peace. And may your presence bring healing, hope, and deliverance to us. We thank you, O God, for your presence here this morning. And we give thanks and we say, come, come, Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. To God be the glory.
Come on, it's worship time, White Rock. It's worship time. We celebrate the King who's almighty, who's all powerful, who's the greatest protector of all. Sing with us as we sing Psalm 3. David made it plain that thou is the lifter of thine head. Let's have those words on the screen. Lord, how will they increase? Come on, let's lift our voices. Lord, how will they increase?
Lord, how will they increase that trouble me? Many are they that rise up against me.
Many there be
which say of my soul.
There is no help for him in God.
There is no help.
That's what the people said. But this is what God says.
But thou, O Lord, art a shield.
Aren't you glad he's our shield?
My glory and the lifter up of my head.
He's the shield. He will lift
thou,
your head up.
O Lord, art a shield for me. My glory and the lifter
up
of my head.
Let's sing that verse again. Lord, how will they increase?
Lord, how will they increase that trouble me? Many are they that rise up against me.
Many there be. Truth of the matter, but thou,
O Lord,
he promised to never leave us nor forsake us. So lift your voices and worship him in song. But thou, O Lord,
art a shield for me.
I cried unto the Lord. Verse number 2, I cried
unto the Lord with my voice,
and he heard me out of his holy hill. I cried unto the Lord. Oh,
I cried unto the Lord with my voice.
And he heard me.
And he heard me down a lonely hill.
I laid me down and slept.
I laid me down and slept.
I awake.
For the Lord sustained me.
But thou, Lord. That should put a smile on your face. That God will never leave us. He will protect us. He will provide. But thou,
Lord, art a shield for me. My glory.
I will not be afraid. Here's the verse of victory. I will
not be afraid of 10,000.
He gave me the spirit of power.
And themselves against me round about.
Say it again. I will not be afraid.
I will not be afraid of 10,000 of people.
Glory.
My glory and the lifter up of my hand.
But doctor, a lawyer, a teacher,
a healer,
deliverer. Protecting us, because we serve a God like none other, one who heals us, one who forgives us and watches over us, that he deserves the highest praise.
Yes. Thank you, Lord.
Come on, just look back over this week. God is worthy to be praised today. We've come for the purpose of giving him praise and glory. Songwriter once said, hallelujah is the highest praise. Hallelujah is the highest praise. We praise
thee, O God, for thy name alone above.
It's worship time, White Rock.
Hallelujah
is the highest.
Is the highest praise.
Come on, one body in Christ, lift your voices.
Hallelujah is the highest praise.
Come on, it's worship time in the house.
Hallelujah.
Praise higher.
Hallelujah is the highest praise.
We give you the glory, Lord.
Hallelujah
is the highest praise. Praise higher. Oh,
hallelujah
is the highest praise. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah
is the highest
praise. We praise thee, O God.
For thy name
alone above.
Good morning. I'm going to ask these musicians to continue to play. I was sitting there and I was observing. Normally I'm meditating, thinking about the message, and I was observing. You know, this is a time that all of us engage in worship. Can I get an amen there?
Amen.
And in some churches, people come to hear the choir or the singers present a song. They don't worship anymore. They come to be entertained. Have y'all noticed that? You know, they get to church and it's set up like a theater where you come to see the entertainers. But thank God this place is not like that. Come on and talk with me. This is a house of worship. This is a place to praise our God. And I was looking around to find out how many of us are literally opening our mouths to sing. I didn't say you have to sing loudly. I just said you needed to sing. Come on and talk with me. You're not talking with me right now. And what we are doing, for those of you who don't know, we are auditioning. We're auditioning for our time when we get to heaven one day. Because every day is a day that belongs to the Lord. And every day is a day of praise and worship to our God. So we're giving you an opportunity to audition, to practice your praise. Come on, somebody say, practice your praise. We're here to practice our praise. We're here to give God the glory. We're here to praise God. We didn't come just to hear Raymond Johnson sing. We didn't come just to hear this wonderful choir sing. Do I have a witness in here? How many of you are willing right now to open your mouths and give God the praise? How many of you know hallelujah is the highest praise? And now I want you to sing as though you're singing unto God. As the song leader leads us in the singing. Let's sing it like we're singing it unto God. Come on.
Oh, hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Jesus is Lord. Take it higher one more time. Oh,
hallelujah
is the highest praise. He's worthy to be glorified.
Hallelujah.
Offer him the fruit of your lips, the sacrifice of praise. Just say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
For today's mercy, say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
For this morning's rising and his blessing.
Hallelujah.
For breath, for life.
Hallelujah.
For his salvation, his saving power.
Hallelujah.
Oh, hallelujah.
Good morning. As a church family, and I feel safe to say this, we are always pleased to recognize and highlight the accomplishments of our children and teenagers. And today, we recognize Jordan Hersey, a 10th grader. His parents are Deborah and Keith Hersey. They're sitting right there. Raise your hand. Amen. In early March, families in White Rock were contacted about a planned oratorical contest sponsored by the Congress of Christian Education, the education arm of the General Baptist Convention of North Carolina, of which White Rock is a member. And the contest gives 6th through 12th graders an opportunity to witness for Christ, to prepare students in public speaking, and recognize them for their public speaking skills. Jordan responded to the invitation and challenge immediately and prepared an outstanding, thought-provoking speech entitled, Transformed from the Inside Out, based on Romans 12:1-2. And I'd like to share that scripture with you. Therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. Do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is for his good, pleasing, and perfect will. Now, we'd like to add, too, that the Christian Education Department of the General Baptist Convention requires that all speeches be memorized. Dr. Linda Hubbard Curtis and I were blessed to serve as coaches for Jordan. And the contest was held on Saturday, April 22nd at a sister church in Chapel Hill. Dr. Hubbard Curtis and Minister Chris Norwood attended the contest representing our church. Jordan did not win in his category. Stand up, Jordan. Come over here. Jordan did not win, but you wrote a wonderful, inspiring speech. You are special. Jordan was so diligent in preparing his speech. He was excited and just said, I'm gonna do this. Amen. And so, Jordan, while you didn't win, I hope you will look back with pride on that day that you made that speech and be pleased and say, Hallelujah, Lord. And so, as a church family, as a church family, on behalf of Pastor Stevens and our entire church body, we congratulate you. You are an awesome young man. Amen. Yes, you are. And we have a gift for you, Jordan. A gift certificate to any place you want to go. All right? And the gift certificate also says, you're awesome. Amen. Wow. So we thank you, Jordan. Would you like to say anything at all, please?
I just want to thank my family and this church for giving me the opportunity to do this. And yeah.
Please go.
That's all. That's all. Thank
you. Jordan, this is your gift. Thank you so much. God bless you. Thank you. You are awesome. All of our young people are awesome, and I am pleased now to introduce Azaria Curtin, who will read scripture and offer a prayer this morning. You too, Azaria, are awesome. Won't you come?
Good morning. My name is Azaria Curtin, and I'm pleased to read scripture and offer a prayer for the people from the Old Testament. I will read from the book of Micah, chapter 6, verses 6 through 8. I will read from the New International Version, and it reads, "With what shall I come before the Lord and bow down before the exalted God? Shall I come before him with burnt offerings, with calves a year old? Will the Lord be pleased with thousands of rams, with 10,000 rivers of olive oil? Shall I offer my firstborn for my transgression, the fruit of my body for the sin of my soul? He has shown you, O mortal, what is good, and what does the Lord require of you? To act justly and to love mercy and to walk humbly with your God." The word of God, thanks be to God. I am pleased now to offer a prayer for the people. Dear Heavenly Father, we come right now saying thank you for another day and thank you for this day. We thank you that last night wasn't our last night. We know that when we are tempted, he will show you a way out so that we can endure. Lord God, please give us a praying spirit and teach us to lean more on you and to walk by faith and not by sight, because we know that even when we walk through the darkest valley, that we won't be afraid because you are close beside us and you will always protect us. I ask that you touch somebody's heart so that they might do good and share with those in need. Lord, we ask for your continual covering over our lives and that you will bring us peace, strength, and love. We ask that you protect our graduating seniors as they experience this change in their lives. Keep them on the right path and help them to always strive for greatness. We ask that you keep us from all hurt, harm, and danger on this day and for every day to come. Allow us to be obedient to your will for our lives and to walk more closely with you so that we may forever be an image of your love. And in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you. Honor to my Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, who is the Lord of my life. To my pastor, Pastor Stevens, to ministers of the gospel, to the members and friends of White Rock, I stand before you today with a word from God. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, as we bow before you this morning, we are here for no other purpose, no other reason, but to glorify and honor you. I pray, oh God, that the words that you instill in me will come from you. I pray, oh God, that hearts will be changed, minds will be changed, God, through your word. Empty me, Father, and fill me with your precious Holy Spirit. Speak to us, God, as only you can do. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. And amen. I just thank God for this opportunity to stand before you today. And I'm excited. I'm excited because God has been good to me. And it doesn't matter what has been going on in my life, God is still good to me. I love to come in on Sunday mornings and see Dr. Martell Perry, because if you ask him how he's doing, he always says, excellent. I love that. Because when you ask me how I'm doing, my answer is always, I am well. Because no matter what is going on in your life, when you serve a master like Jesus, when God is the Lord of your life, it does not matter what is going on in your life. Your soul is well with the Lord. So our message for today is living a life that pleases God. Living a life that pleases God. You know, we go through life sometimes always trying to please somebody. When we were young, our goal, our desire was to please our parents. We didn't want them to be disappointed in us. We get married and we want to please our spouse, and we get a job and we want to please our boss, and we have teachers and we want to please our teachers. But the one God wants you to please is Him when you are one of His children. Because I have learned that when you live a life pleasing to God, then everything else is going to work out. In our scripture that was so wonderfully read by Azara, I'm not going to reread that scripture, but we're taken from the book of Micah. Micah was one of the 12 minor prophets, and he was the first prophet to predict the downfall of Jerusalem. According to him, the city was financed by dishonest business people, but Micah was known for criticizing unjust power. And it sounds like 2023 when we hear things like that. Micah was always advocating for the poor, and he prophesied the downfall and restoration of Judah and Israel, and he even prophesied about the coming of Jesus Christ. Micah assures Israel that what he is about to say is coming from the Lord. See, when God speaks to us, and we give that word to somebody else, we have to let them know this is not me that's speaking, but this is of God. Micah warned the people that their sins had brought judgment on them. They had acted wickedly. They worshiped idols rather than trusting God. They were also taking possessions from other people. They were robbing from the poor and giving to the rich. Doesn't that sound like 2023? Micah had declared a coming judgment for their sinning and future. The answer that the Lord gives to Israel teaches us much about the character of God and what God requires of His people. What have I done to make your life a burden is what God asked them. What have I done? Have I burdened your life by requiring you to live by higher standards? Have I burdened your life by requiring you to worship me in holiness? Have I burdened your life by asking you to serve others and to treat others justly? What have I done to burden your life? What is God doing today for Christians that sometimes they feel like it's a burden to live holy and righteous? They say, it's a burden. It's heavier. It's more than I can do. So God is saying, what have I done to you that you're not worshiping me, that you're not seeking me, that you're not praising me, that you're not serving me, that you feel like I have put a burden on you? What can I do that is pleasing to God? What have I done to make your life a burden? And then he reminded them, and you know, sometimes God has to remind us of what he has done for us, what he has brought us through, what he has blessed us with. He said, I brought you out of Egypt and a life of slavery. He said, I sent Moses and Aaron and Miriam to lead you out of the bondage. He said, I blessed you on the journey. I conquered your enemies. I performed miracles right in front of you. I turned curses away from you, and I blessed you. All I have done to take care of you, I blessed you. I kept you, and I kept my promise to you. Why do you seem like it has been a burden for you to serve me? I protected you, provided for you everything that you needed. Is God talking to Israel, or is God talking to us today? God could ask the same questions of his children today when our lives look just like the children of Israel. Some feel like it's a burden to be a Christian. Some feel like that the Lord requires too much of me, a burden to worship him totally, a burden to surrender our lives totally to him, because God doesn't want just half your heart. He wants all of your heart. The Lord has set us free from slavery, just like he set Israel. He has set us free from the sin, the penalty of sin, and he has set us free from the power of sin. God has delivered us from the power of sin. Who can say that living for God is a burden? God reminded the children of Israel through Micah to always remember where he has brought them from. You know, sometimes we've got to stop and go back and say, Lord, I remember who I was before you saved me. Because I'm going to tell you right now, there is not a person in here that was holy and righteous before God came into their life. There's not a person in here that was pleasing to God before God saved you one day. What can I do to be pleasing from God? How can we live a life that is pleasing to God? But see, Israel was focusing on their rituals, their religious rites. Then he was focusing on, first they asked God, would you be satisfied if we offered you a year-old calf? Would that be satisfying to you? Then they asked him, what if we bring thousands of rams? And what if we had 10,000 rivers of oil? Would that be pleasing to you? They asked whether they should bring their firstborn to him. Lord, will that be pleasing to you? God is not about your religious acts. He is not about your rituals. He is not about you sacrificing anything, because he has given us his greatest sacrifice. The sacrifice increased. And as I was studying this, I noticed that they kept getting more and more in quantity. First he said, can I give you a one-year-old calf? And then he said, can I give you 1,000 rams? And then he bumped it up a little bit, and then Israel said, can I give you 10,000 vessels of oil? You know, we can't do too much for God and think he's going to bless us just because of what we're doing. We can't increase what we're doing just for recognition or fame if we're not doing it for God. No matter what you do for God, if you're not doing it for the right reason and the right purpose, it's not going to be pleasing for God. Sacrifice was what the children of Israel was taught. That was part of their Jewish religion. But sacrifices was never intended as a way to please God. And neither is it intended for the path to salvation, because God has sacrificed his son for us. So the answer to Israel's sin problem was not more sacrifices. The answer was a much deeper observance. What the children of Israel needed and what we need is a change of heart. That's how God can work through us, when he changes our heart. How can we live a life that is pleasing to God? What is God willing to accept from his people as a way of life? If you're not sure what God requires of you today, it's all in the Word. All you have to do is read through the Scriptures. God makes it clear and plain to his children how we should live a life that's pleasing to him. But then God responds when Israel tried to make a bargain with them. He said, I have shown you already what is good. You already know what is good. It's not like you're in the dark. It's not like you don't know. I have sent prophets ahead of Micah to prophesy to you. You already know what is good. God does not need our desires, our religious rites. He is not interested in how many times you come to church each month. He is not interested in how many choirs you sing or how many ministries you serve in. He is interested in the condition of your heart. That's what's pleasing to God. So what is God asking for people to do? What was God asking the children of Israel to do? What is God asking us today in 2023 to do? God does not want burnt offerings. He wants you to come into his presence. He wants you to worship him. He wants you to worship him and praise him. He wants you to lift him up and glorify him. He doesn't want to hear you complaining as the children in Israel did time after time again. Because as children of God, when somebody asks you how you're doing, the first thing that should come out of your mouth is a praise to God. Because God has blessed us. God has provided for us. God has delivered us. God has protected us. God has given us everything we need. And the first thing out of a Christian's mouth should be glory to God. Hallelujah is the highest praise that we can give. And sometimes, yes, we do have to share what's going on in our lives. But that's not complaining, because we need each other. We can be encouraged by each other. But I was sharing with somebody just a few weeks ago, there's a difference in being a complainer and complaining. And the Holy Spirit gave me this thought about every now and then I may bake some cookies for my children, or I may bake a cake for my children, but that doesn't make me a baker. It just means that every now and then I'll do some baking. But a baker is somebody that does it all the time. A baker is somebody that has a passion for it. A baker is somebody that's good at it. A baker is somebody that is their career. So don't make complaining your career. Don't make complaining what you do and who you are. In everything God blesses you, give him praise. God loves to hear the praises of his people. But according to the scripture, this is not what God is desiring for his people to do. It is not to do expensive gifts. It doesn't even matter what you put in the tithe offering if your heart is not set on God. It's about your heart. So this was God's response. And what does the Lord require of you? Now, we're going to talk about those requirements, because when something is required of you, it's just like young people when you get ready to graduate, or you get ready to go from one grade to the next. There is a requirement that you have to meet before you can be promoted, before you can be advanced. And so God is saying, this is what is required of you if you want to be pleasing to me. First he said you've got to act justly. And then he said you have to love mercy. And then he said you've got to walk humbly with your God. And those are three action words. You've got to act, you've got to love, and you've got to walk. And so he is telling them, it's not the amount of the person that what you do, it's not the services, it's not the rituals that you do, it's the condition of your heart. I cannot stress that enough. God wants our heart. He wants our whole heart. When he told them to act justly, he says, in every situation, I want you to do whatever is right. I want you to do whatever is fair. I want you to treat everybody fairly and everybody justly, not just the people that you care about, not just the people that look like you, not just the people in your neighborhood, not just the people in your family, but God said, I want you to treat everybody fairly. It's not like when somebody comes to you for help and they don't look like you do, that you're not going to help them, that you're going to send them somewhere else. God said, treat everybody fairly and everybody justly. Do just. It's not something that we think about. It's not something that we talk about. God said it's something that I require of you to do. Now, when God requires something of you, it's not Pastor Stevens asking you to do it. It's not Mama and Daddy asking you to do it, young people. It is what God requires of you. It is so wonderful to have our young people recognize and acknowledge on third Sunday. It is so wonderful, Jordan, to see how God is using you. It is so wonderful to see how God is using the young people in our congregation. It is so wonderful to see how these young people are coming out of godly homes who have values and standards for holy living. It is so wonderful to see that God has raised up young people in his bodies of Christ that go out into the world, out into the schools, out into the communities, so that others will see the love of Christ in them. That's what pleases our Father. So he's telling us, what is our response in a world of sin and injustice? It's not like acting just like the world. Because if we go out in the world as children of God, and we act just like they do, when we are unfair and unjust, when we judge others because of who they are or what they don't have, when we act like we're better than somebody else because we have a little bit more and live in a bigger house, when we judge people because they don't have a job and they're standing out there on the corner begging for people, we're not treating people fairly and just as God has required of us. God tells us we need to show mercy and kindness and most of all love. But I'm going to tell you something right now, church. We can't love the way God expects us to love without the love of Christ in us. Then God says we are to love mercy and we are to love kindness. And that means what we do to other people, how we express God to other people. It means that we are going to refuse to hold a grudge against somebody. It means that we're not going to try to harbor revenge against somebody. It means that we're not going to try to get even with somebody. It means that I'm not going to start talking to you anymore because I don't like what you said to me last Sunday. It means that I'm not going to come in here and sit beside you and not speak to you. It means that if I see you and you need something, but you talked about me last week, I'm not going to help you. He said you need to love mercy and love kindness, because after all, God showed us mercy when he saved us. Did we deserve it? No. Did the person that talked about you, do you think they deserved it? I don't know. But God said it doesn't matter whether you deserved it or not. He said, I didn't save you because you deserved it. I didn't save you because you earned it. I didn't save you because you're good enough. I saved you because I loved you. And I have work for you to do. What can we do to be pleasing to God? Yeah. And then he told them, he said, you need to walk humbly with God. Yeah. Now, I'm going to tell you, when I read this text through and through, I thought, Lord, you should have put that verse. Because we can't love justly. We can't act justly. We can't show kindness and mercy unless we are walking with God. That means to live in a constant communication with him. That means you've got to have a strong prayer life. That means that you've got to align your life in the will of God. That means you've got to have fellowship with him. That means that you have to submit your will to God's will. Because everything we think we need is not what we need. Everything time we think we know what's best for us, it's often not what's best for us. Every time we pray and ask God to bless us right now, God could be saying, it is not time right now. So we have to align our walk with the will of God. And that's a daily walk. That's a daily walk. Every morning when you get up, ask the Lord to walk with you. Walk with me, God. Walk ahead of me so I will see where I'm going. Walk ahead of me and protect me from any harm or danger that may be out there. Walk with me, God, every single step of the day. I want to be in your footsteps. I want to walk in your will. So be with me, God. And that walking is a metaphor. It's used in the scripture to describe the overall direction of one's life of living. When we're walking, we're moving forward. When we're walking, we're advancing. When we're walking, we're growing because we're exercising ourselves. When we're walking and following the Lord Jesus Christ, we are growing in our walk with him in our spiritual life. This is the very heart of everything that God purposes for us. He wants us to act justly. He wants us to love mercy and kindness. And he wants us to walk closely with him. Yeah. To walk humbly with God means that we understand that God is in control. control. You know, some people have a hard time with that control word. Control. Nobody's controlling me. God has to be in control. When we understand that we are sinful human beings, that's who we are. That's how we were born. But we also have to understand that we have been forgiven by our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And we also have to understand that there are times, even in our saved state, that we make wrong choices, say wrong words, do the wrong thing, are disobedient to what God has called us to do. But we have a Father that we can go to and repent of our sins, and God will forgive us. I can remember when I was growing up, when I talked about pleasing God, and I can remember that my desire was to please my parents. I didn't want them mad at me. And one day when I was, I don't remember how old I was, I started a fire and set the house, just set a fire in the house. And my father said to me, I'm going to spank you. My father had never spanked me in my life. But what I felt, it was not the spanking, it was I have disappointed him so much that he would even contemplate spanking me. That's how our relationship with God should be. Lord, I want to please you. I don't want you to be disappointed in me. I don't want you to be angry with me. I want to live a life that's pleasing to you. The word said, let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. We want God to accept our conduct, accept our words, accept our behavior, but it all starts with your heart. Amen. Micah connects our faith with our action. Yeah. Our care for those in need are what we need to focus on when we're worshiping God. Yeah, yeah. God uses the gift of salvation by grace. And Micah describes what God wants from us in return. God saved us one day. God freed us from the penalty of sin. God took us out of bondage. And God says, this is what I want you to do in return for what I've done for you. I want you to act justly. I want you to love mercy and kindness. And I want you to walk humbly with me. And so you got to look at that word humbly. Because you've got to understand that you need to bow down before a living God. You need to understand that whatever you're doing, you're not doing in your own energy and knowledge. And you need to understand, young people, that where God has brought you to right now, how you're doing in school, how you're interacting with your peers, is what God has done for you. I hope you understand that whatever you do, it is because God has given you that knowledge. God has given you that wisdom. God has given you that heart. And I want you to understand that your parents and grandparents loved you enough to see that you were planted in a church that was teaching you and ministering you and working with you. Sometimes the others in your life are going to want you to do things that you know are not pleasing to God. But you have to do what you know is right. You have to do according to what the word says. You have to stand before God one day. And God, you want to hear, well done, my good and faithful servant. So when others come to you and want you to do something that you know is not right, that you know is not pleasing to God, you have to be willing and strong enough to walk away and say, no, I will not do that. I will not go there. I will not participate in that. I will not do that. Why? Because I am a Christian and I love the Lord. Don't ever be ashamed to tell your friends that you are a Christian. Don't ever be ashamed before God to say, yes, I love the Lord. Yes, he is good to me. Yes, he has saved me. Young people, you are a light in your church, a light in your community, a light in your school, a light among your friends. Why? Because they see Christ in you. Live a life that's pleasing to God, even if it's not popular, even if it's not what your best friends are doing. Because one thing for sure, some of your friends didn't come out of homes that had value and praise for God. Some of your friends were not raised by godly parents. Some of your friends did not have role models of Christian women and men in their life. So you are that role model to them. walk in your way. Walk with the Lord. Let him be your guide, but be obedient to what he has called you to do. You have a great future ahead of you, young people. God is blessing you in a mighty way, but don't forget to give God the glory and give God the praise for all that he has done and will continue to do in your life. God has always made it very clear to what it takes to please him. And unsaved sinners, nothing they can do will please God. Because the word said all of our righteousness are as filthy rags. That was us one day before we came to the Lord. Those who are operating in the flesh are opposed to living and walking in the Holy Spirit. The only way to live a life pleasing to God, and I want you to hear me, is to surrender your authority to the Lord and receive his son Jesus Christ as your Savior. That is the only way you can be pleasing to God. You have to confess with your mouth and believe in your heart the Lord Jesus, that God has raised him from the dead. And the word said, you shall be saved. The only way you can act justly, the only way you can love the way God instructed us to do, the only way you can walk humbly before the Lord is that you have a relationship with God through Jesus Christ, his son. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no one can get to the Father except through me. If you really want to know how to please God, if you really want God to smile when he looks at you, and he sees his son Jesus. If you really want to be pleasing with everything you say and everything you do, then walk a life that is pleasing to God. And once you have been born again as a child of God, we are pleasing to him. We are accepted into his family. We now are his sons and his daughters. He has cleansed us. He has forgiven us through our faith in Jesus Christ. So today, if you have not received Jesus, if you have not been adopted into the family of God through faith in Jesus Christ, if you know that what your life is not pleasing to God, then I say to you today, God is waiting for you to surrender your heart to him. That is the greatest thing that you can do, is to surrender your life to Jesus Christ. You don't have to wait until tomorrow when things are better. You don't have to wait until you clean yourself up. You don't have to wait until you change, because God says, come just as you are. When each one of us surrendered our lives to Christ, we were not perfect and still are not perfect. You will not be perfect until you come face to face with Jesus Christ. But God says, come as you are right now, because he does the cleaning. He does the working on you. He does the change. He will make you a new creature. He will revive you and restore you. God will do it. How do I know he will do it? Because he did it for me. How do I know he'll do it? Because he did it for Pastor Stevens. How do I know he will do it? Because he did it for every one of his children. But what God wants from us is your heart. Then you can love. Then you can forgive. Then you will be pleasing in the sight of God. We cannot be pleasing to God without the power of the Holy Spirit. We cannot be pleasing to God without a relationship with God through his son Jesus. Jesus is the answer for all the world today. So do you want to be pleasing to God? And I want you to think about it. I want you to examine yourselves. I want you to ask God, am I pleasing in your sight? And listen to the voice of the Holy Spirit. Don't assume that just because you've been living the same way for the last 10 or 20 years that God is pleased. Don't assume that. Don't assume that what I think is right is right. Don't assume that, because God has set his standard for his people in his word. And if you're not in his word, then you don't know what God's standards are. So you need to get in his word. You need to get on your knees. And you need to pray and say, Lord, cleanse me of any unrighteousness. Bring to my heart anything that I'm not doing or I'm doing that's not pleasing to you. And God will do the rest. He wants you to surrender to him. He wants you to open your heart and receive him. He wants you to walk in his will. And his will may not always be what you want, but you can be in no better place than to be in God's perfect will. So I say today, are you living a life that is pleasing to God? Are you walking holy and righteous? Because what happens when you're living a life that is pleasing to God? When you go out into the hedges and the highways, when you go out into the alleys and the grocery stores, then the world will see Christ in you. And what will happen as they see the love of Christ in you, that will draw them to God. They will see the Spirit of Jesus in you. They will hear the love of God in you. They will see how you don't make a difference to them because they look different. They will see that you just love them despite of who you are or what kind of life you have or what kind of history you have with you. They will see the love of Christ. And as you walk Christ, as you live godly, as you live humbly before the Lord and not puffed up in yourself, they will see God and draw them unto your Father. So I ask you today, church, is your life pleasing to God? Is that your first priority, is to please God? Or is it to please your children? Is it to please your spouse? Is it to please your pastor? Your first priority should be, am I pleasing to God? Because I'm going to tell you, when your heart is open to pleasing God, when your heart is willing to do whatever God has asked you to do, when your heart is a heart of praise and not complaining, your walk will match your heart. What will come out of you is the love of Christ and the mercy and the joy of Christ. So ask yourself, as you go through today, is my life pleasing to God? And if it isn't, you have time. Because the blood is still running warm in your veins. You have time. So today, if there's one that does not know Jesus as their personal Savior, if there is one that knows I am not pleasing to God, if there's one that has something in their life that they need to surrender unto the Lord and turn it over to God, now is your time. If there's one that believes in their heart that Jesus died for their sins, that he rose again after his crucifixion, and that one day he's returning again for his people, and you are not pleasing to the Father, I ask you to come. You can come by letter. You can come by a candidate for baptism. You can come by Christian experience. But God is asking you to come. He's opened the door for you. And he's willing and waiting for you to come. Come to Jesus. Come to Jesus. That's the first thing you have to do to please God, is come to Jesus. He loves you. He loves you. With an unending heart. It doesn't matter what you did last night. It doesn't matter what you did last week. God loves you. And he wants a relationship with you through faith in his son Jesus. And he can show you. He can teach you. He can walk with you about how to please him. Just come. Just give your life to him. Surrender your heart to him. Just come. Come. Come unto him. Come unto him, all those who labor and are heavy laden. And he said, I will give you rest. If you're tired of living in the streets, if you're tired of living without Jesus, he said, come. If you're tired of trying to live life on your own, trying to figure out what to do next, come to Jesus. If you're tired of other people trying to tell you what to do, come to Jesus. He is your source of strength. He is your comfort. He is your power. Come to Jesus. Come to Jesus. Yes. Each
guide me. I felt like preaching. What a great message we heard from the Lord through Reverend Mitchell. Thank you, Reverend. What a marvelous word we've heard today from the Lord. We have now come to a time when we're going to have Deacon Jenkins come and make the request that I know you will respond to.
And praise God. Glad Pastor had some actual comments, because I was almost out of it over here. Because when you know God is leading you, praise God. I stand before you today, and we heard the message from Ram Mitchell. And she told us it's not a matter of what we do for show, but it's what we do from our hearts. What we do for what God has told us to do. What we do in obedience to Him. So at this time, as we ready for our tithes and offering, just take time to pray to God and say, Lord, what would you have me to do? Just ask God. Because we always go to God when we want something. But sometimes we don't want to go to God when we want to be obedient to Him. And we know sacrifice is one thing, but obedience is more important. So as we come now for our offering, just take a second to ask God, Lord, what would you have me to do? Don't do it because Deacon Jenkins is saying it. You do it because God has asked you and told you. And He don't ask us for all. He just asks us to be obedient for His tithes. His tithes, they aren't ours. They're His in the beginning and His offering. So let us pray, and afterwards, we come and bring our tithes and our offering. Lord, we thank you right now for the word. We thank you, Heavenly Father, and we ask that we be obedient to what the word has directed us. We thank you for those that have a heart to give and those that's willing to do what's pleasing in your sight. We thank you so much, God, for being our God and for the word. Keep us in your perfect peace. Keep us in your perfect love. And whatever those give, let them give from a giving heart that's been obedient to you. We love you, we glorify, and we praise you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You know, those of us here can come forward And if you have to send it by way, or you're not here, we'll take it through the mail at 3400 Fairfield Street. We have Gilify, we have PayPal. We have a way, and you have a way, if you want to be obedient to God, to give his tithes and offerings. Now, it's giving time. Let us come forward.
And said, this is the day you need to connect with Christ. How many of you,
be honest now, how many of you wish you knew that that would have happened with you today? Amen. And that's why we believers should invite others to worship the Lord with us. Do you agree with me? It's just not pastors, not ministers, not leaders in the church, but it's all of us, the body of Christ, to reach out for others, to make them a part of this wonderful fellowship in Christ. And if you're listening by way of stream, we're worshiping live at 9, and I mean all the way live, at 9:30. Our young people at 8:30, and we had midweek services at noon and at 6, and we thank God for this ministry of White Rock Baptist Church. Now, next weekend is Memorial Weekend, and each year we start what we call casual Sundays. Now, what casual Sundays mean is just what how it sounds. We dress casually. Now, some of us are already casual, and that's fine. But we ask that people come and don't dress as if you're on your way leaving church going to the beach. You understand what I mean? So we mean casual as in respectfully casual. Amen. Next Sunday, Memorial Weekend, we begin a summer of casual dress, should you choose. And if you choose to wear what you're dressing in now, it's fine. If you want to put on your tie, it's fine. If you want to wear a certain kind of dress that you think that reflects the character of who you actually are, that's fine. But we want you to know you're free. And we want you to know that we wanted all of us to come together in the spirit of Christ. We're ready to leave and depart from this place and thank God for what we've heard and felt today. Come on, choir. And now, may the grace of God, who is our divine creator, and the love of Jesus, who is the Christ and our Savior, and the abiding presence of His Holy Spirit go with us to bless us. Bless us with His protection, bless us with His prosperity, and bless us with His peace, now and evermore. And now will all the children of God sing together. Amen.
For joining the White Rock Baptist Church's pre-recorded worship of Christ service today. Please join us next Sunday and invite your friends and families to join us as well. May God continue to bless each and every one of you.